All right, we're back again, and we are throwing it way, way back again.
Again.
With some Bible trivia.
Is today Thursday?
Today is not Thursday.
I'm getting my days all mixed up.
It doesn't really matter what day it is anymore, really.
I know, we're all just at our house, and as long as it's not a Sunday or a Wednesday or a, you know, Monday or a Thursday or Friday.
Then it must be a Tuesday.
Or a Saturday.
See
what I did there?
Finally found a subject. I don't know. Days of the week.
Well, let's play throw it way back on a Thursday. How well do you know your Bible trivia?
And we've got last week.
Did you win? Did you beat your sister?
Quit inciting violence.
I just am competitive. I'm sorry. I never had a sister that I could beat. Either literally or...
That was probably for the best. We should just get into the questions, probably.
I have children.
Or you get yourself in trouble.
I have children now.
Oh, they can take a
beat. I never beat them. Never beat them.
Except for board games, basketball, football, everything else.
Everything else.
Right, Tyler? Right?
Right. Maybe. Okay.
For a little while longer.
Where in the scripture, question number one, where in the scripture do you find the story of the Tower of Babel?
Babel. No, blah. Babel.
But isn't this the story where when they were done, they all like went blah, 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 in all the different languages?
That's kind of maybe what it sounded like to everybody, but it's Babel.
Okay, all right.
Like so, what we're doing right now, Babylon.
Where in the scripture do you find the story of the Tower of Babel?
Zephaniah 2,
ooh,
1 Chronicles 10, Genesis 11, or Ruth 3. We're all over the place. It could be anywhere.
Man, I'm really like an A for this.
Really?
Yeah.
That's.
Let's see. Was I right?
C. Genesis 11 is the correct answer, as Brother Jay Sulks. One of these days, we're going to find something he's good at. One of these days.
Maybe. I'm good at beating my children at games.
Well, let's see if maybe we go on to question two, your luck might change.
Question two is...
This is a biggie. Where will you find this story?
So look at the picture. Check read the out. Hashtags, maybe. I don't know. I haven't looked at them yet. Hashtag Last Supper.
Is that my boy Thomas asking for one more bun? James is like, whoa, what about me?
Classic. Yeah, maybe, you know, do you know where the story's found? Is it Matthew 26? Maybe Mark 14?
Better yet, maybe Luke 22 or John 13. Those are your choices.
Now, some of the other questions have, like, been easy to kind of narrow it down. Yeah, no. Not this one.
This one's all in the Gospels. I mean, it obviously took place there, and so you've got a tough decision to make.
Yeah, so what's it going to be? You got your guess?
Don't waffle.
Matthew, Mark, Luke, or John?
The answer is... Drum roll. All the above!
All of that!
Ooh.
So, here's the question. So, do they get it right if they only guessed one, or do they have to guess all of them?
Half a point for each correct answer.
I'm good with that. Half a point for each correct answer.
So, if you thought maybe it was in two, you get a point.
Yeah.
Thought it was in three. I don't know. Make up your own rules. Fight about it. I don't know.
Yeah.
Arm wrestle.
Hey, we're just going to go to the next question while you guys fight about it. I hope you're with us. Here we go. The prodigal returns. In what book did Jesus tell this story?
Throwback Tuesday to the barbecue of the century.
In case you didn't know, Brother Gary, Thursday actually starts with a T too. But I know what you're doing because this is a Tuesday, not a Thursday.
I'm making it applicable.
Yeah, and I'm talking about Blabble.
Blabble. So what's your answer? Luke, Acts, Ephesians, John. Just which book?
I'm going with Throwback Tuesday.
Not even a chapter. In the book of Luke.
Luke, chapter number 37.
There's not 37 chapters. Do you know what Luke did for a living?
Besides
write his own book?
He had an Instagram account.
This is still Paul the Epistle, still. See?
Wasn't he like a meat grinder?
That's exactly what he did.
Yes!
You got one right.
All right. Tell him for real what he did.
He was a doctor.
Yeah, he was a doctor. All right. I think this might be the last question.
Ooh, that's a weird-looking picture.
That is a weird-looking picture. Can you figure out what it is? Here we go. Where do you find this story? So we're not even going to, like, read the hashtags. You got to read them for yourself.
Yeah, take a look at that. That's pretty interesting. That's definitely a sea monster of epic proportions.
I'll just say this. You need to listen to your parents and do what they say, because you don't want to end up like this guy.
No. Disobedience never.
Is it Hosea? Well, not is it Hosea. Where do you find this story? Is it in the book of Hosea? Is it in Daniel? Is it in Obadiah? Or is it in Jonah?
You know, if I was in the fish like that, I'd be Obadiah. Obadiah. Okay.
You might be smart, but you're not good at jokes.
I'm trying.
Next answer to this question, since I don't know
first
why it's the next answer,
question.
We're just going to show you the answer. You
Jonah.
Guessed it. It's Hosea.
It's even lit up on the screen for him and he missed it. Oh my goodness.
Yeah, reading was never my strong suit.
More colors or
all right.
The other clues.
So did you win? That was four questions today. And we had some bonus points in there for Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, so you still could win.
You could have surpassed, not beat, you could have surpassed your sister on bonus points.
Your jokes make me Obadiah.
Oh my goodness. Our time is up here, folks.
Why don't you guys enjoy a song?
But hey, yeah, so we're going to sing a scripture song from 1 John 3:1. Some of you may have heard it. It's, "Behold, what manner of love the Father hath given unto us." All right, really simple. There's that part, and then we're going to a part where we say, "That we may become the sons of God," okay? So if you want to follow along with the lyrics, you can find those in 1 John 3:1. The words are a little different, obviously. But yeah, follow along and sing. Hopefully you can learn along. And don't mind if I mess up here a little bit on the keyboard. All right, I'll do my best. All right, so behold what manner of love. You ready? Behold what manner of love the Father hath given unto us. Behold what manner of love the Father hath given unto us. That we should be called the sons of God. That we should be called the sons of God. Hey, pretty simple, right? You want to try it again? Hopefully you got it down a little bit. We'll try it again, maybe twice. All right, and then we'll finish off. You ready? Behold what manner of love the Father hath given unto us. Behold what manner of love the Father hath given unto us. That we should be called the sons of God. That we should be called the sons of God. Behold what manner of love the Father hath given unto us. Behold what manner of love the Father hath given unto us. That we should be called the sons of God. That we should be called the sons of God. Great singing, boys and girls. I know that's kind of new. Maybe we'll do it again sometime. But yeah, that's a scripture verse. So remember, that's in 1 John 3:1. So good singing.
Ho, ho, ho! And now, a moment with Pastor Ross!
What do you get when you cross a rabbit with an oyster? The oyster bunny. What do bunnies do when they get married? They go on a bunny moon. How can you tell where the Easter Bunny has been? Eggs mark the spot. What kind of bunnies can't hop? Chocolate bunnies. Why don't you see dinosaurs at Easter? Because they're egg-stinked. What kind of stories do rabbits like best? The ones with happy endings.
gonna make some quick coffee. It'll wake me up pretty well. Let's see. I'll use the Detroit mug. All right. Oh man, we're out of coffee grounds. I know what to do.
All right, this should do.
All right.
What had happened after Jesus died? He was to be, well, I'm not entirely sure what Roman custom was for what they were going to do with the body, but it wasn't going to be pleasant. Okay, they clearly didn't have much value for the body of a criminal, and being that they looked at Jesus' body as a criminal, there probably weren't going to be great plans for honoring his body or after his death. But there was a man named Joseph. Now, this is not Joseph, Jesus' earthly father, and this is also not Joseph from Genesis, okay? There are a lot of Josephs in the Bible. This is Joseph of Arimathea, the Bible tells us. And he asked Pilate, if you remember, we didn't talk about this this week, but Pilate was the one who ended up condemning Jesus. They cried out to Pilate. Pilate had the authority to free Jesus if he wanted to, but due to the pressure of all the people yelling for the crucifixion of Jesus, Pilate gave in to them. And so Pilate had authority over all that was happening here in this Roman government with this particular situation with Jesus. And Joseph of Arimathea, he asked Pilate if he could have the body of Jesus so that he could bury it properly. He had a tomb that he could put Jesus' body in. And so Pilate allowed it. Pilate allowed Joseph to have the body. So Joseph took the body of Jesus, and he did very proper and respectful things to the body, and allowing it to be wrapped properly, and they buried it in this tomb, all right, in this place in a garden that was very beautiful, okay? And so they set Jesus there. The Romans, they had heard some word that Jesus might come back to life, and so they set some soldiers there and everything, just out of a little worry, and things don't really turn out the best for them, okay? But we're going to be picking up in John chapter 20. So if you've got your Bibles, turn to John chapter 20. All right, we're going to read a number of verses in this chapter, just going through and seeing what God has to say about what happened on that third day. All right. So, verse number 1 in John chapter 20. It says, "The first day of the week cometh Mary Magdalene early." Now, Mary Magdalene, she was somebody that Jesus had ministered to greatly. Jesus had helped her so much through her life while Jesus was ministering on earth. She used to be demon possessed. She had all sorts of problems, and Jesus helped her. Jesus helped save her, and she was so thankful. She gave her life to him. And so here she comes to visit the tomb. It says, "The first day of the week cometh Mary Magdalene early, when it was yet dark, unto the sepulchre, and seeth the stone taketh away from the sepulchre." So here Mary Magdalene comes to the tomb, likely to maybe pay her respects or something for Jesus, and just kind of honor what he had done. And she comes to the tomb where this massive stone had covered up the opening. The tomb is almost like a small cave of sorts where bodies could be laid, buried there, and then massive stone would come over and block it from being opened ever again. Okay, it was too heavy for any normal person to be able to move that thing. It was massive. Okay, and so she comes to the tomb, and she sees the stone, that massive stone, was taken away. It was gone. She thought somebody had moved it. So verse 2 says, "Then she runneth and cometh to Simon Peter and to the other disciple whom Jesus loved," that's John, "and saith unto them, They have taken away the Lord out of the sepulchre, and we know not where they have laid him." So here she comes. She runs to the disciples, and the disciples who she had grown to know over the time of Jesus' ministry. And she said, "Hey, someone has taken Jesus' body. The stone is gone. He's not there. We need to do something." And verse 3 says, "Peter therefore went forth, and that other disciple, and came to the sepulchre." So Peter and John immediately, they run after. They want to see what's going on. So they ran both together, and the other disciple did outrun Peter and came first to the sepulchre. So John was going so fast, he ran past Peter and came to the sepulchre. He wanted to see what happened. Like, how could this have happened? Verse 5,
And he, stooping down and looking in, saw the linen clothes lying, yet went he not in. Then cometh Simon Peter following him, and went in unto the sepulchre, and seeth the linen clothes lie, and the napkin that was about his head, not lying with the linen clothes, but wrapped together in a place by itself. So they come to the tomb. John comes, and John just looks in. He doesn't enter. Peter just bolts in. Peter just goes right in. Now, if you remember some of the stories about Peter, you'll know that's very much in line with the kind of person he was. So he just bolted into the tomb, and he looked in, and they saw the linen clothes, the wrappings that they had put around the dead body of Jesus, just to make sure it wouldn't have some issues, you know, to keep it nice, kind of the things they would do with oils and such. It was all taken off, but it wasn't just ripped off. It was folded and put in a nice place there where his body had laid earlier. And so they're wondering what could have happened. Verse 8, then went in also that other disciple which came first to the sepulchre, and he saw and believed. That's John. John believed. For as yet they knew not the scripture that he must rise again from the dead. Now, oh man, this is a little unfortunate, because if you look through the Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, you see Jesus, he talked a number of times about what his plans were for being on earth. He didn't come to earth just to hang out. Okay, he didn't only come to the earth at this time to heal people from their physical problems. Okay, he didn't come to earth, even though many thought he was going to at first. He didn't come to earth at first just to rule the earth. Now that's what he's going to do when he comes the second time for his second coming. But at this point, that's not what his plan was. He told them many times the reason he came to earth, the reason Jesus was on earth, the Son of God, was so that he could seek and save that which was lost. And how was he going to do that? And he mentioned this as well. He had to die. He had to die for all sinners. Jesus had to die. He told them this. And he told them that he wasn't going to stay dead, that he was going to rise again. And you find that in the Old Testament scriptures as well. They should have believed this. The disciples should have believed this, but yet they still didn't have a full belief of that. Yes, they heard what Jesus said, and yes, they loved him, and yes, they believed that he was God, but they still struggled to believe some of the things that he said. They struggled to believe that he was going to come back. Yet here it happened. And it took them to see with their own eyes to finally believe. A little unfortunate. Then the disciples went away again unto their own home. Verse 11, but Mary stood without at the sepulchre weeping. And as she wept, she stooped down and looked into the sepulchre, and seeth two angels in white sitting, the one at the head and the other at the feet where the body of Jesus had lain. Mary Magdalene, she looks in the tomb again, and there are these two men in white robes. They were angels. She didn't quite know this, but they were sitting in there. And they say unto her, woman, why weepest thou? She saith unto them, because they have taken away my Lord, and I know not where they have laid him. And when she had thus said, she turned herself back and saw Jesus standing, and knew not that it was Jesus. So there's Jesus, risen again. He's standing right there with her. She sees him, but she still is so convinced that he's gone, she doesn't even recognize him. Verse 15, Jesus saith unto her, woman, why weepest thou? Whom seekest thou? She, supposing him to be the gardener, saith unto him, sir, if thou hast borne him hence, tell me where thou hast laid him, and I will take him away. So she thinks Jesus is the gardener of the place that they're at, and she thinks that he's responsible for taking away the body. She tells him, please tell me where he is. And verse 16, Jesus saith unto her, Mary. She turned herself and saith unto him, Rabboni, which is to say, Master. Verse 17, Jesus saith unto her, touch me not, for I am not yet ascended to my Father, but go to my brethren and say unto them, I ascend unto my Father and your Father, and to my God and your God. Mary Magdalene came and told the disciples that she had seen the Lord, and that he had spoken these things unto her. So she thinks that he's the gardener, that he's some other person, and he says her name. It's all he says, Mary. She immediately recognizes him, calls out to him, Master, sees that he has risen again. Her belief, it's come to fruition. He's risen again, and she gets to see it. She's saved, believing in his death and resurrection. And then Jesus tells her, go tell everybody else. Go tell everybody else that I'm back. And boys and girls, isn't that our responsibility as well? Listen, we don't have the opportunity to see physically. We don't get to physically see Jesus risen again. All right? Just like many, we have to believe. We have to believe that he died for us. There's historical evidence for that. But then we have to believe that he rose again. We have to believe that he came back to save us. It takes belief. It takes faith. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and thou shalt be saved. It doesn't say see the Lord Jesus Christ and thou shalt be saved. Many saw Jesus die. Many saw him after he had risen, but still didn't believe. They thought that it must have been some trick, some magic trick or something. But in reality, he had actually come back. No, it doesn't matter if you've seen him or not. What matters is if you believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. Believe on him, and thou shalt be saved. Believe that he died for you, that he rose again, and thou shalt be saved. That's what it takes. And listen, boys and girls, if you know that, and if you have called upon the Lord in your belief, that means you're saved. And if you've done that, our responsibility then, as God says, is to serve him by, we need to tell others that he's risen. Let other people know. This is a time better than ever where people are wondering, you know, what's going on. You know, people are thinking more about Jesus probably than ever before, with just how the world is right now. And listen, I don't know how long it's going to take before you're going to be able to start getting outside, getting out in the town again, being able to see some friends and everything. But hey, use some of those opportunities to talk about Jesus, to talk about his death and his resurrection, talk about what he's done for us and how he saved us and how others can be saved through that. It's a wonderful thing. And the more it spreads, the more people can be saved, the more people can hear the gospel. Remember that, boys and girls. Hey, we've talked so much this week about how it's just a great time of celebration, a great time of celebration for what Jesus Christ has done for us. And all throughout this week, we should be talking about it, remembering it, thinking about it, meditating upon it, just pondering what he's done for us. That shouldn't end this week, though. After Resurrection Sunday, our remembrance of him, our thinking about him should not end. And the talking about him, all those things should continue. We should never stop trying to learn about Jesus, trying to get more of a knowledge of what he's done for us and sharing that with others. It's a wonderful thing. So boys and girls, remember that. Remember to believe in case you haven't. All right. And once you have, don't stop celebrating. Don't stop sharing with others. Don't stop thinking about what he's done for us. It's an amazing thing. And oh boy, I don't know about you, but I cannot wait to thank him personally when we get to heaven. Have a wonderful weekend, boys and girls. Don't forget to remember.